Hope your old chunk go off.
Because I probably won't even see it.
She wore red for a reason.
I did.
She's in the office.
Where the book is. Where the book is.
Well, good afternoon. Welcome to our candidates forum for the 2015 political season, sponsored by Georgia Public Broadcasting, GTB Savannah, Savannah Morning News, and savannahnow.com. My name is Bill Kelso, your moderator for this afternoon's forum. We'll have a total of 6 sessions today. This is number 3. Of course, 5 of these sessions are focused on the aldermanic districts, with the final forum this evening for the mayoral contest. Our format, each forum will consist of 2-minute opening statements from each candidate, then questions from our panelists, who I'll introduce in just a minute, and then each of you will also be given an opportunity to give a 2-minute closing statement. We'll wrap this up. When a question is asked, just as a reminder, each candidate will have 1 minute to respond to that question. From that, if a result of the question, if I believe a rebuttal is appropriate in that, then I will allow for that. That'll be no more than 20 seconds. I would like to remind all candidates that this is a forum where ideas and views on particular issues can be exchanged. This is not intended to be a formal debate, so my role is to keep the exchange of ideas and views flowing within the parameters of the forum. We ask you, as the audience, please keep noise down to a minimum. Please either turn off your cell phones or put them in silent mode. I do want to remind everybody that we are streaming live this event to savannahnow.com. And recordings will also be posted on gpb.org/savannah by tomorrow afternoon. Our panelists, we have Mr. Eric Curl. He's a city reporter for Savannah Morning News and savannahnow.com. And we also have Ms. Emily Jones, who's the morning edition host and reporter for GPB Savannah. Again, each candidate will be asked questions from our panelists, and you will have 1 minute to respond to that question. Susan Catron from the Savannah Morning News will be our timekeeper. So with that, let's begin. Candidates in this forum are running to represent districts 3 through 4. So from District 3, please welcome Ms. Kim Dulek and Mr. John Hall, incumbent. From District 4, please welcome Mr. Julian Miller and Ms. Mary Ellen Sprague, who is the incumbent. We'll now start with our opening statements. And Ms. Dulick, if you will begin. 2 minutes, please.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. My name is Kim Dulick. As he said, I'm running for District 3, which is mainly encompasses the east side of Savannah. And I have a background in public service since I graduated from high school and college, public health degree at the University of Georgia. But my background in public service did not ever encompass running for political office. This is my first jump into this realm, and I'm very glad to be here. We really need to have some issues addressed in Savannah. I worked for the Department of Defense in a civilian capacity and working with mobilized families, and also for the Carl Vinson Institute of Government, which is an arm of the University of Georgia. Back in the old days when the internet was coming into being and I was teaching politicians how to use the internet and how the internet could benefit us in providing governmental services around the state. We've come a long way, baby, in that regard, I'm sure we all know. But today, in stepping into politics and trying to do what I'm doing, I work as an advocate now for the elderly and the developmentally disabled. And when bullets came through our kitchen window back in March, and I started taking a long, hard look at the crime problem in Savannah and the underlying issues that were leading to our crime, I decided that it's time to advocate for the people of District 3. And that is why I'm here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ula. Mr. Hall, please.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I am John Hall, and I am very appreciative of the opportunity to speak to you this afternoon as a candidate for re-election to the Savannah City Council from District 3. Savannah is a great city, and it is my goal to continue to make it even greater. As a native of Thunderbolt, Georgia, I served 4 years as a councilman and 4 years as mayor pro tem. My experience there was hands-on and an invaluable experience to me in developing my vision for service and in understanding the needs of my constituents. In 2005, I moved into the city of Savannah, where I am completing my first term as an alderman. I have found that being a good listener is a fine attribute that encourages others to depend upon my leadership. Solving problems come about when I can develop consensus with a majority of my colleagues to get a policy enacted. That is what aldermen do. We make policy based upon the recommendation of our city manager, and after considering the impact of the policy on our constituents, I am especially eager to hear from those who feel they have no voice in what happens in their neighborhoods and with city government. Once I understand their perspectives, I am committed to helping them feel included in decisions that are made that will impact their lives for good or ill. I want to improve the quality of life for all Savannians, their safety, their opportunity for upward mobility, and the chances for their children to realize the American dream.
Tom. Thank you.
Mr. Miller. Thank you. I'm told I might not get another chance to do this. I'm going to dive right into it. This weekend we had a juvenile court crime forum where we learned that Chatham County is the worst county in the state in sending juvenile offenders into the system for adjustments. 1,000 entries, 947 in 2014. 80% of those were referred by the police department. Only 60% of those, by the way, were misdemeanors. A misdemeanor is an opportunity for somebody to intervene and stop somebody from going over a cliff. These are all youngsters that we're dealing with. They were missed opportunities because we weren't set up for it. At that forum, we had a large contingent of young men, young boys who came in from other parts of the country to help us with this. One of them went down to Yamacraw Village to look for things for himself, ended up getting robbed, shot in the back, and is fighting paralysis in the hospital. He's one of two visitors to Savannah who were shot this weekend because we don't have enough police officers there. Not one incumbent has stepped forward to tell the city we came in too late, too low with our salary adjustments. We're not taking care of our police department. We're losing people every day. Despite how you twist the numbers, we're down about a fourth of the department. We can't go on that way. We're not protecting our people, and this is what I'm running.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Ms. Sprague, please.
Yes, my name is Mary Ellen Sprague. I have been a city alderman for the last almost 8 years. Prior to that, I was a school board member for 8 years, as well as a president of the library board for 2 years. I believe that we as a city are so much better than we were 4 years ago. Our economy is in wonderful shape. Our tourism is the best it's ever been. Our millage rate is down. We have a AAA rating. We have $34 million fund balance. Our construction is up. Our universities are booming. Yes, we do have a crime problem, but it has only manifested itself in the last 2 years. Prior to that, the crime rate was going down. We as a city and a city council recognize that we have an issue, and we are dealing with it. We will have 100 new officers by the end of this year. We have increased their pay. Last month, we only lost 3 officers. So what we are doing is having an impact. We put over $6 million more dollars into policing this year. We built a $3.9 million training facility that went online 2 months ago. We do care. Over half of our budget goes to public safety. Safety is the number one issue, and we intend to keep focusing on it over and over and over until we get the crime rate down. And we're not just focusing on enforcement. We're focusing on prevention. We are focusing on outcomes and going after the 300 worst criminals. We are focusing on technology. We are focusing on every single area it takes to make this a safe place for all the residents of Chatham County. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Frey. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to our panelists, who will begin the questions. Remind our panelists, you have 1 minute to respond to the question. And as you're giving your comments, if you're looking for a sign, Susan Campion down here in front will give you a 5 second warning as we're getting close to the minute. Please.
First of all, thanks to all the candidates for joining us and to everyone here who's come to these forums today. A couple of you have already started addressing crime, which I think is one of the big issues on a lot of voters' minds. And so first, I'd like to hear from all four of you, what is your plan to reduce crime, especially violent crime, in Savannah? And, you know, what are your plans, maybe some of them outside of the police department, too? You know, what are other ways to improve public safety beyond filling those officer vacancies, increasing salaries, and all those issues that have already come up a bit?
With that, I'd like to go ahead and start with Mr. Hall first. We'll work our way down, and then Ms. Newark will finish up with you.
Thank you. Besides filling vacancies where they exist and adding more officers as a cushion, I think we need to understand the underlying issue of the crime situation here in Savannah. We need to insist that everybody is on a upward mobility trajectory, and we must end or reduce the amount of poverty that we have here in our city. And we must insist that there is room for all of us, all of our people, to advance through the job markets, through training, and all of these things. So we have a lot of work to do other than filling vacancies.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Mr. Miller.
If you're going to address poverty, you do it by bringing in jobs. You bring in jobs by bringing in new businesses and industries, expanding the business and industry you've got, or trying to increase tourism. None of that happens when crime and education are not at their top. They're not here. Crime is the one we're focusing on. When Jack Lumpkin became chief on November 10th, he stood in front of city council and said, I can't rebuild this department paying $10,000 to $12,000 less than comparable departments, and I got to have cars to do it with. City council agreed, but waited 10 months before they addressed the recruit pay. Then the recruits were making more than people who were training, so guess who left? Now we have an unexperienced department, and more people are leaving every day. They don't have backups, they don't have cars, they don't have equipment, they don't have technology. City council knows this and has done nothing about it. That's my plan.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bill. Ms. Frank.
Yes, to address what he just said, actually we did do something, by the way. We immediately commissioned a pay and compensation study. When that was going too slowly, we instantly jumped ahead of that and instituted at corporal level to bring more police up in terms of their pay and compensation. When that was still going too slow in terms of recruitment, we raised their pay. And in terms of equipment, they have wonderful equipment and we're always adding more. But in terms of policing, it's not just about enforcement. It's also about reaching the young people, reaching those people in the middle school and ninth grade who decide to join gangs. We can do something about that, and we should do something about that. We have summer programs. Major Zabel runs a wonderful summer program for at-risk youth at Savannah State. We are expanding that program. We also started a pre-apprentice program this summer to provide jobs for young people. I think these are great ways of prevention.
Thank you. Ms. Hewitt.
And they have all mentioned very important things, and some of the things that I have discussed with others in conversation and know that these can be implemented here in Savannah for downtown, for the safety there. Certainly, I believe that we need to have surveillance cameras to help protect our tourists and our own citizens that are downtown. I know that that would bring a level of security to the people of the city that are visiting and those that are just coming downtown to enjoy themselves. That has been something that's been one of those issues that has been looked at and has been in the works for a while, and I don't know that we know where it stands today. Another issue is with the youth and bringing our youth gainful employment and opportunities in their own neighborhoods and taking them in the afternoons after schools into job training programs and things that can advance them.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Oh, you started. You're funny. I lost count. My apologies. Next question from the panelists.
Good afternoon, candidates and audience. Thanks for coming out. My question to you is, each year the City Council compiles a list of state legislation they would like to pass. What state legislation would you push the Council to lobby for as an alderman?
Let's start with Mr. Miller, we'll then work our way down and wrap up with Mr. Hall.
I would like the state to go back and revisit the transportation funding. I think it's a big problem for us, and it involves, among other things, the recruitment of new businesses and industries to the area. I think it also addresses other issues that we have. That's the first thing that would come to my mind. Anything we can do to try to help with crime, juvenile justice, and trying to defer some of the young people we have that are going over the cliff where it comes to crime or poverty.
Thank you. Ms.
Frank? I guess the first thing that comes to mind is the complaints that I've heard from a lot of businesses about their property taxes going way up very quickly. I know that's happened both on Broad Street and in Havisham shopping area, and it's just unbelievable. I, as a business owner, would not want to see my property taxes go up exorbitantly. We have a Stevens Day bill for residential property. We don't have one for business properties, and I think it's a whole lot to ask for somebody's property tax to go up $9,000 and $10,000 and $12,000 a year, or 50% in 1 year. So I think where I'm going to focus on, if reelected, is redoing the way that we appraise business properties. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Ms.
Dooley. I agree. Transportation and fast rail line is something we need to look at more broadly in this area. But my primary interest in legislation at a state level is for mental health waivers. I feel like so many of the problems we have underlying with crime and poverty stem from mental health issues that are undiagnosed or untreated because that population is not able to, they don't have access to services, first of all. We don't have very many programs here in the area, and that is because our state and federal government right now do not sponsor any type of mental health waiver for those on Medicaid. I encourage everyone to reach out to your own legislators and be clamoring about this, because I talk to so many people who work in prison system or have retired from the prison system, and the level of mental health issues that they're dealing with there that come in are incredible, and we need to help these people.
Mr. Hall.
I would push to change the compulsory education age. I think it's incomprehensible that a child can quit school at the age of 16. That needs to be raised. We need to raise it, and we need to reach out to every legislator in this area. We just need to make that happen. It is, like I said, unconscionable for a 16-year-old to say, I don't want to go to school anymore. And what happens when that child leaves the education system? The street gets that kid. So we have to have help on that end. And if we are to eliminate youth crime, juvenile crime, so I think that's very, very important that we lobby our legislators to change that law.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Thank you very much. Back to our panelists. Next question, please.
A couple of you have raised the issues of poverty and also of economic development. So what would your specific plan be to reduce poverty in Savannah and to bring in businesses that have high-paying jobs?
Ms. Bray, you want to start, please?
Okay. Well, first and foremost, I mean, poverty is a catch-all term for a lot of different sorts of things. Homelessness is poverty, working poor is poverty, so I think that you have to drill down to really, for me to be able to answer that question. But I will talk about economic development. Economic development is obviously imperative in terms of reducing poverty. I have been sitting on a group called the Creative Coast as a board member, and our focus is on creating our own. I would love for Savannah, Georgia to have another Microsoft. I believe that we could. I believe that we could generate that. We have some wonderful universities here that generate wonderful, bright, creative students. We need to learn how to keep them in Savannah. We need to learn how to help them create jobs, create companies that make jobs. And we need to become Tech City USA. The jobs will be better. They are high paying. We need 3,000 more coders in Savannah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Ms. Gould.
Due to the amount of work I do with the elderly and the young people who have developmental disabilities, I have a special look into their life and how poverty affects their lives. And I truly feel like we have a lot of great and wonderful, strong programs already existing here in Savannah to address these issues, that we need to give more support to, that we need to make sure they're getting out into the grassroots areas of our poorest and most needy areas of the city so that they can see what their needs are to help them. In the realm of economic development, what I'd like to see is more attention, manpower, and money put towards our Black to Bright program. Maybe some monies that are going for a sporting arena that I don't think we truly need downtown. We don't have the parking, but I believe that the blight and what can be done to the neglected areas to bring businesses in through incentives would be a beautiful thing.
Thank you. Mr. Hall.
Education would be the greatest equalizer. Now we have to make sure that our schools are strong. K through 8, K through 12, everybody needs to buy into our school system, our public school system. And when we educate, we can bring people out of poverty. I know that we are going to have poor people, but when the vast majority of our population is educated, we can reduce poverty and crime at the same time. And we must insist on opportunity for all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Mr. Miller.
I agree with him on education. Education and crime are the two biggest things we have going against us. Those who are born into poverty have a 70% chance. Actually, 70% of the people who were born into poverty are doomed to live in it their entire life. The way you get out of poverty is get a job. To bring jobs in here, again, you have to expand existing industries, bring in new ones, or increase tourism. None of that's going to happen when we have crime with the problems that we have. If we don't get politics out of policing, we're not going to be able to address it. There are things we can do with education. There's also things we can do with high-speed internet. We lost Volvo to Tennessee because they had high-speed internet in Chattanooga. It was something that was pitched to the city, and the city dodged out of it. These are things that we can do to help bring in more jobs and help fight poverty.
Thank you very much. Alex?
Alderman Sprague, you and Tom Rodeau were the sole votes against the height map amendment for the Kessler Hotel project on West River Street. While Alderman Hall, you actually voted in support along with the majority of the council. I want to know if you all stand behind those votes and why, and how the challengers would have voted if they had been on council at the time.
Can you repeat the question? I had a hard time understanding the first part of it.
I want to know if you would have supported the height map amendment for the Kessler Hotel project on West River Street if you had been on council at the time.
I voted against that, and I stand by that vote. I believe that Savannah has a certain mystique, as Alderman Rondeau would say. I think to block out the view from the people that currently own property was negative toward that area of River Street. I think River Street can become more of a kind of a it won't be the same River Street. And while long term I did end up voting for the project, that particular area of the project I was not in favor of. I don't think we're going to have the same River Street. It will be a wonderful project, it will bring jobs, but I think he could have done it without raising and done it effectively and economically without the height that he went for. And just as the Hyatt was a game changer on River Street, I think this is going to be a game changer as well.
Let's jump to Mr. Hall, if you'll respond, sir.
Yes, I voted yes, and I stand by that vote even today. When we look at the economic opportunities that it will present for a lot of the people in Savannah, especially in the hospitality industry, yes, I was very supportive of that, and yes, that's the way I voted, and I would oppose that.
Let's go back to Mr. Miller, and then we'll finish up with Ms. Dula.
A couple of centuries ago, somebody wanted to build a four-story house in New York, and everybody raised Cain because it was going to block the view of someone. That four-story house is still there, and it's surrounded by 50-story skyscrapers. Yes, I would have allowed that. I don't think what we had was too intrusive. I think progress needs to be made. We brought in a lot of jobs. That's going to help this community bring in even more tourism, and I think overall it was a good plan.
Ms. Stewart?
Yes, I agree too. We need more rooms for tourists downtown. Kessler is a fine room, and they run a nice shop. It's going to be a wonderful development. I think we were right in causing them to respect the aesthetics of Savannah and keeping the height requirement where it was, and I would have voted for the project.
This is a question for the District 3 candidates. You've both named blight as an important issue in your district, and so what would be your plan if elected to address blight?
Start with Mr. Miller, and then Mr. Dulick and Mr. Hall.
Thank you.
My apologies.
Although I'll be glad to answer.
Sure.
Yes, we do. We have a great deal of neglected property throughout District 3, not only down what people tend to talk about the most, the Pennsylvania corridor. We've got the lovely Savannah Gardens project, but then anchoring it on either end are still a lot of blighted properties and empty lots that are going unused. And like I mentioned earlier, the Blight to Bright program that the city already has in force is something not a lot of people know about, and I think we need to get the word out there to entrepreneurs that are looking to start businesses. I think we need to offer incentives to those people who've been forced off of Broughton because of the increase in taxes, and give those mom and pop Savannah-based businesses another place to create an incubator for small business. And also look at tax incentives and other things that we could do to encourage more entrepreneurship.
Mr. Hall?
I totally agree that we do have a blight situation, but one thing that we as a council need to do is change some ordinances as it relates to how we treat blighted property. We just can't go in and take someone's property and put it up for sale. But we have to shorten the amount of time that it takes for an individual to bring the property up to code. And this is some self-criticism that we as a council need to take. We're not doing what we need to do. And we need to change the ordinances to make them more suitable for people of low income to be able to purchase some of these houses through rehabbing them and that sort of thing. So I think we need to change the ordinances.
Thank you. Next question, please.
Bear with me here. The city is about to launch a 12-week scaled-down version of the Savannah Serves program proposed last year by the Tourism Leadership Council. With the hopes of eventually launching the full program. The pilot program consists of 10 to 12 ambassadors charged with assisting visitors, disposing of litter, and keeping an eye out for criminal activity. While the $131,000 pilot program will be paid for using existing funds budgeted for temporary labor, the Tourism Council has proposed charging a 25-cent fee for purchase of $10 or more at businesses located downtown, essentially, in the program zone. Would you support implementing such a program and fee proposed by the council to fund it?
Let's start. Not to change the question, is it a yes or no response you look for, or do you want them to elaborate?
Sure. They can expand on
okay. Okay. With that said, Ms. Dulick, would you please start?
First of all, if you repeat the name of the program again, Eric.
It's the Savannah Serves Ambassadorship Program. The full program is expected to consist of 40 to 50 ambassadors responsible for providing information and enforcing tour-related ordinances, 15 Green Team members charged with beautification efforts, and 30 off-duty police officers responsible for crime prevention in the program zone.
It sounds like a great idea to me. I think if we're employing some of our youth as ambassadors that are unemployed, that would make it even more desirable. But I like that idea.
Thank you. Mr. Hall?
I think it's a wonderful idea. Anything that we can do to engage our citizens and be accommodating to our tourists, I think it's a wonderful idea. And having the off-duty police officers to augment that from the safety, public safety standpoint, I think it's a great idea. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Miller.
I think you have to do something to fix things downtown. It was interesting that when I first came here in 2005, we were talking about that ambassador program. And it's interesting that 4 weeks from the election, we finally got around to funding a little piece of it. I think we have to do that. I think it's money well spent. There are going to be some businesses that have some problems with it because they do have an awful lot of expenses. But overall, I think it's going to help bring more people downtown and more business downtown. I think it's a good plan.
Ms. Frick?
Yes, I think it's a wonderful plan, and I want to give a shout out to Michael Owens of the Tourism Leadership Council, who is, and Bridget Liddy, who have been working very, very hard to make all this happen. I think it's going to be a wonderful program that will benefit the tourists, benefit the residents downtown, benefit the city. I think it's a win-win.
Another slightly long one, not quite long, but an early step that council often takes in embarking on many city projects is to hire a consultant to study the proposal, study the feasibility of it, the set of options, whatever it might be. Sometimes those studies return recommendations and the council acts on them. Sometimes they don't end up, you know, acting on what comes out of those studies. And so I'm curious to know from each of you whether you think such studies are a useful tool for the city and are they the best process for city development projects? And if not, what alternative method would you offer to figure out whether proposals are feasible?
Okay. Mr. Hall, what's
I think when this company moved off of Bay Street, they just didn't come out here and put a building up. I think you studied it. I think we have to have studies to move forward on different things, but I would definitely recommend that city staff do a lot more of this and come back with some cogent recommendations for us. Yes, this stuff could be handled in-house, and I think the public deserves to have us save some tax dollars for studies when we can. Yes.
Okay. Mr. Miller.
I think it's a beautiful example of how this city does not operate professionally and responsibly. We end up doing studies not because we really want the results of the study, because we disagree with them, you just ignore the study. But it's covering your rear end. Rather than making a decision on your own, you can always come back and say, well, we hired a consultant, we did the study, and came up with this. The way it should be operating, we should have department heads that will make the recommendation. We should have enough confidence in those department heads to bring that recommendation forward. Occasionally, you'll need a study, nowhere close to what we have now. It shows that either we don't have the confidence in our department heads, which means we should replace them, or we are too nervous about making a decision without something to blame it on. I think it's a big problem we have in our city right now.
Thank you. Ms. Frick.
I believe that if we are doing a one-time, if it's a one-time situation where our staff does not have the expertise, then we by all means should hire a consultant. For instance, right now we have consultants looking at how we should size and configure our new arena. I don't know anybody in the city of Savannah that has that expertise. And the cost per seat of in building an arena is huge. So I think it is well worth the money to hire a consultant in those types of situations. Yes, sometimes we don't always act on the studies, but I think that means a lot. For instance, we hired a consultant to look at whether we should have a cruise ship line. We were serious about looking at a cruise ship line. It wasn't just to cover our backs. We truly wanted to see if it was feasible and it would make sense for us to have a cruise ship line here in Savannah, Georgia. After we got the results from the study, we discovered how expensive it would be, how long it would take to create such a cruise ship line. So we decided not to do it. So sometimes I believe there are more.
Yes, as others have said, we have enormous talent in this city, if not on our city staff, in this city in other capacities, engineers, architects, people, civil engineers, who can help us in this realm, and we may have to engage their knowledge in certain situations, but I always feel that should be our last resort before writing a carte blanche check to have a consulting group come in. we definitely need to look at all the aspects and what we have here on the ground as at our own disposal and the talent here.
Thank you. Other questions?
I wanted to get your all's thoughts on the city's program to contract with minority and women-owned businesses. I was curious if you thought that was a successful program and needs some work. And also, if hiring local and women and minority-owned programs should supersede other factors like the costs of the contract.
Mr. Miller, would you start?
I think we have to look out to women and minority-owned businesses, but I think there's an extent to where you go. I think it is not handled very well. In other cities I've been in, they broke projects up into smaller components so smaller companies could bid on. If a minority company cannot get within 10% of the low bid, then we probably need to be more respectful of the public's money and move forward. There's always extenuating circumstances, but we have way too many extenuating circumstances here.
We have an ordinance that I'm extremely proud of called the Local Preference Ordinance. And it actually is a win-win for everybody because everybody bids on a project. If a local minority or women-owned entity, or even just a local entity, is within 5% or 3%, depending on the contract, they are allowed to match the low bid. That doesn't mean that the city ends up paying more. It means they end up paying the same, but they get to buy it locally. It has been absolutely wonderful, particularly for the car dealerships of all things. We get to buy from our local car dealerships instead of buying from Atlanta, which I think is a win-win for everyone. So it doesn't cost the city any more money. We hire locally. We use locally. It's a good thing.
Thank you, Ms. Frank. Ms. Doolin.
I think that's a very good program that Mary Ellen mentioned, but I think we have to be very careful when we're reviewing applications from minority and women-owned businesses and how they are vetted, because I know of many who have used their wives as the owner of the business to get the benefits of a women-owned business, yet they're not the ones really benefiting and running and the day-to-day operation of the business. So I think we could do a better job at vetting the program that we have, and I believe in the women having those opportunities.
Thank you, Ms. Bill. Mr. Hall.
There again, when done right, this is an excellent opportunity for minorities, women, here in Savannah on the local level to get some contracts to make some money. And this is all a part of the poverty equation, the anti-poverty equation, where you're putting people back to work, where you're helping your neighbor, your friends. You are doing, if it's done right, if company A hires company B, C, and D to do the painting, the plumbing, and all of that, if it's done right, and you have qualified minorities, I'm not saying give anybody anything. I'm saying keep it here local. Too many times, construction jobs all around this city, you see tags from out of this county.
Thank you, Ms. Bell.
To take a step back and look at some more big picture things, from each of you, what is your vision for the city of Savannah?
Let's start with this break.
I would like to see a city that is economically thriving, where every citizen feels safe and secure.
Ms. Doolin.
I would like to see a city where all of our generations are working together to better the lives of one another and in gaining respect and living by the golden rule.
Mr. Hall.
Adopting a strategic approach plan for change, integrate environmental thinking, and insist on opportunity for all.
Thank you. Mr. Miller. I think Savannah is a wonderful location for a great city. We're not great yet. We could be world class. What we will need to do is have a plan to get there. We don't have a master plan. If we do, nobody knows what it is. So we end up with a bunch of haphazard projects that are thrown in helter-skelter, and they don't build to the great good. I envision a city that is planned with measurable steps over the next few years to get us to where we need to be, including locations for the kind of events and buildings that will come forward. I see us being a world-class city. We're not there yet. We're far cry from it, but we're closer than any other city I know of, and we have the opportunity.
Last question, if you have
one. Are we going to close?
I'll ask one more question. Okay. I just want to know where y'all envision the funding coming for all the public safety improvements that you'd like to see implemented.
I learned, and I'm not fully educated on this yet, but it sounded like a wonderful idea to me, that many other port cities in the United States have a tax that is rendered to the cargo that's coming in on the boats that come into the harbor. I don't think we have that tax. We don't get anything out of that in the city. And I think that we need to look to that business to see what they can offer us as far as helping to support public safety in our city and all the things, the infrastructure, and those things that we are all benefiting from, and they too, as well, big business in Savannah getting those benefits too at the port. Thank you.
Mr. Hall?
I would never advocate raising taxes, but for public safety, we all are going to have to think long and hard and dig deep. If we don't raise taxes, we're going to have to do some serious belt tightening and getting more done with less. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Miller.
Wow, I don't think we need to raise taxes. We got a $347 million budget, a $32 million reserve. There are also reserves all over that budget. We also have a county that is willing to participate if we can all get together and act as adults in this. With that kind of a budget, keep in mind, your number one priority of any government is to protect its people. Out of $347 million, we certainly can protect people. We're not talking about that much money. Most of the salaries are already in the budget. We're talking about raising the salary. What we did was we did a study and we said, well, raises salaries start here and they go up to here. We're going to try to go to a midpoint, which to my mind was stupid. That's trying to get to mediocrity. We need to get up to the top. That's going to be salaries. Everything else we need is capitalized. We have the money in the budget. We can go forward right now.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Ms. Sprague.
Yes, as he said, the money is already in the budget. I, in fact, just looked back, and last year there was $1.9 million that was allocated to the police department that was not spent, which, as far as I'm concerned, is downright criminal, given our situation. So we have a wonderful new police chief started November 10th of last year. I think he will spend the money. He is focused. He is working on getting in great officers. I don't think that we have to worry about not having $1.9 million this year. I think he will spend his budget, and I think it will be well spent. It will be spent on raises. It will be spent on police cars. It will be spent on the NIVIN system. It will be spent on the training and the personnel for the NIVIN system. It will be spent on more cameras around the city. It will be spent on cameras on the back of cars to be able to read the license plates and determine very quickly whether a car is stolen or not. It will go for all the wonderful things that we need.
Thank you, Ms. Spring. And so with that, now we will begin to wrap this up, and offer each of you an opportunity to give a closing statement. That closing statement can be 2 minutes. We started Ms. Bulick in the opening. What I'd like to do is start with you, Ms. Sprague, and then we'll work our way down to you, Ms. Bulick, to wrap things up.
Yes. 4 years ago, our economy was in recession. We had a different city manager. We had a different police chief. We had a different city attorney. We had a brand new mayor and 4 brand new city council members. We were in a position of change, and we have changed a great deal in 4 years. In the midst of all this, we actually passed a wonderful SPLOST that the people of Chatham County had their faith in us to pass. Our economy since then is doing beautifully. All those new people, city manager, city attorney, police chief, are doing a great job. I am very, very happy with the direction Savannah, Georgia is going in. We have obviously an issue with policing and with our crime problem, but we are all on top of it. We are doing everything a city council member could possibly do to change the way crime is happening, or what is happening in Savannah in terms of the crime. We are dealing with it through prevention, through enforcement, through communication, through every possible means that we can. And communication is very key. The people of Savannah have to talk to the police force, and the police force has to talk to the people of Savannah. We need more community policing. And we know that, and they are working on that. So yes, I believe as a city we are going forward, everything is going in the right direction. We do have this one problem with policing, we are dealing with it, and I think in 4 years we are going to be a first-rate, number one, best city in the United States. Thank you.
Thank you.
My phone and I totally disagree on this. I don't think we're doing enough. I don't think we're going forward at all. I'm not happy with anything I'm seeing of this. In 5 years as the public information officer for the police department, I was on every major crime scene. And I dealt with victims' families, officers, other first responders, firefighters. And I see the frustration, not only on the victims. We tend to look at crime like a bunch of numbers. The people I saw on the street, the families that were standing around, didn't see numbers, they saw people. And we're not doing enough to protect our people here. The raises that we talked about were not enough, nowhere close. They were, they're so confusing. You have sergeants making more money than lieutenants. This is something the firefighters have been fighting for 3 years. They've gotten absolutely nowhere. This is very important to the future of this community. If we don't fight crime, officers are frustrated, they're leaving out of frustration, they can't figure out how they're going to get their next paycheck, and nobody will sit down and talk to them. We treat them as a criminal issue rather than an HR issue, which is another problem we have in the city.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Mr. Hall.
Thank you. Ultimately, public safety is people. Our citizens must take on responsibility for their actions. Whether it's driving a car properly, respecting property, both public or private, becoming educated so that good decision making can be a part of everyday conduct. In the short term, police officers must be highly visible in areas plagued by crime. In our business areas that we depend on to sustain the economic vitality of this city must also be protected by a vigilant police department. Foot patrol, officers on bicycles, and mounted police must be available resources for our communities. As responsible citizens, we must be prepared to pay for these needed services until we can educate our citizenry and build communities where poverty is not isolated to become a breeding ground for crime. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Ms. Miller, please write this up.
I think this spend first and think later mentality of our current city council has gotten us into a world of hurt here in Savannah. I, too, don't feel like we're getting what we need. Of course, we're seeing a lot of action right now on the council and around town that should have been going on all during their term. I think there's been a head in the sand approach. I know the people in my district are frustrated, they're scared, we're losing people who are moving out. And I, for one, when bullets came into my kitchen window and decided to run for office, said, I will not be afraid. I will not be run out of my home. I will step up and fight for Savannah, and I hope that I have your vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Doolin. So with that, that brings conclusion to this forum. So on behalf of the Savannah Morning News, savannahnow.com, and GPD Savannah, thank you so much to our candidates for joining us today, our panelists for joining us with their questions, and of course, to you, the audience, who joined us today for this session. Our next forum will begin at 3:30 with candidates from At-Large District 1. Again, as a reminder, you will find coverage of today's forums at savannahnow.com, in tomorrow's edition of the Savannah Morning News, and podcast, which will be posted of this and all the other forums online at gpb.org tomorrow afternoon. Thank you all very much, and have a great afternoon.